بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، نستضيف لنا أن نستضيف في هذه الليلة المباركة فضيلة الشيخ محمد بن عبد الوهاب العقيل حفظه الله تعالى، وإذ نشكر الشيخ على تلبيته هذه الدعوة مرة أخرى ليتحدث إلينا ولإخوانه وأخواته خاصة في الغرب. فنسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفق شيخنا الفاضل إلى كل ما يحبه ويرضاه. فتفضل يا شيخنا، بارك الله فيكم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، فأهلا وسهلا بكم أيها الإخوة والأخوات في هذا اللقاء إن شاء الله تعالى الذي نتواصى به بالحق ونتواصى بالصبر. أنقله لكم من هنا، من طيبة الطيبة مدينة النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأسأله سبحانه في هذا، في بداية هذا الدرس، أن يجعلني وإياكم من أتباعه وأصحابه في الدنيا والآخرة.
First of all, our beloved Shaykh حفظه الله تعالى, he gave us السلام. And he praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he sent the salat and the taslim upon the one who was sent as a mercy to all mankind, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and upon his companions, all of them. He said to proceed. I welcome all of you, my dear beloved brothers and sisters, in this talk, which we will enjoy the truth and the patience upon one another. He said, I will be speaking to you from the Tayba Tayba, the city of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, and first of all, in the beginning of this talk, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make me and you as well from the followers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and from his companions in this life and in the hereafter. Naam ya Shaykh, sallallahu alayhi.
Mawdu'u hadhihi al-kalima, ayyuha al-ikhwatu wal-akhawat, حول أمر محدث مختلف وبدعة ظهرت في العالم الإسلامي، ولكن وللأسف الشديد سببت فرقة بين المسلمين وعداوة، حتى أن بعض المسلمين أقام الولاء والبراء عليها، وطعن كل فريق.
So the Shaykh حفظه الله تعالى, he said, the topic of this talk is about something that had been innovated, something that was introduced. It's an innovation that it is well known in the Islamic world. Innovation that caused discord and division amongst the Muslims. Rather, this innovation has caused enmity amongst the Muslims, so much so that some groups, they use this innovated thing to actually refute others. And so therefore they become refuting one another because they establish al-wala wal-bara upon this innovated matter in this deen of al-Islam. Naam ya Shaykh, sallallahu alayhi.
هذه البدعة أيها الأحبة في الله وهي بدعة ما يسمى بالمولد النبوي، غير موجودة ولله الحمد والمنة في بلادنا ظاهرا، ولكننا رأيناها في كثير من بلاد المسلمين، وقرأنا ما كتب حول هذه البدعة. طعن من يفعل هذه البدعة، ولذلك احتاج الأمر إلى دراسة علمية لهذه البدعة، فانبرى لذلك علماؤنا حفظ الله أحياءهم ورحم أمواتهم، ودرسوا هذه البدعة في رسائل عديدة، أصدروا بشأنها عدة فتاوى، ونحن بهذه الكلمة بحول الله وقوته سنذكر بعض ما يتعلق بهذه البدعة على وجه الاختصار.
The Shaykh حفظه الله تعالى said, this innovation, my dear beloved brothers and sisters, which is the innovation of that which they is called the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, first of all, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thank him that this innovation is not found in our country. He means Saudi Arabia. He said, apparently is not found. He said, but it is found, and we saw it performed and celebrated in many of the Muslim countries. He said, we have read on it, and that which was written about it. So for the troubles, I'm skipping something, I'm not getting some of the Shaykh is getting. I'm gonna do my best, inshallah ta'ala. So for all these reasons, the Shaykh has said, to refute this innovation, the ulama, our scholars, may Allah preserve those who are still alive amongst them, and may Allah have mercy on those who are dead. He said they have compiled many books and scientific studies on this innovation. So they refuted it with the adilla, with the proofs in so many books. Actually, so many Islamic verdicts has been issued born against this innovation. He says so, and we in this talk of today, we will mention to you some of the things that have a connection with this innovation, and we're going to try to summarize it for you. نعم يا شيخ صلى الله عليه.
أولا، أصل هذه البدعة وزمان نشأتها. المتتبع لكتب الأديان قديمها وحديثها يجد أمرا مهما جدا، وهو أن الأديان إذا حرفت بعضها يأخذ من بعض، وإذا بقيت الأديان كما أنزلت من الله عز وجل فإنها تنفرد بميزات عن تلك الأديان المحرفة. وهذه البدعة، أعني بدعة المولد، يعني أنها موجودة عند أصحاب الديانات الوثنية قديما، فقد عرف أصحاب الديانات القديمة كالهنادكة والفراعنة واليونان احتفالات كثيرة بمولد آلهتهم، وهذا من العجائب أن الإله يولد ويحتفل بميلاده. ثم توارثت الأديان المحرفة هذه العقيدة وهذه الاحتفالات، فأصبح لكل إله يحتفل فيه بمولده، اختلاف وكثرة.
So the Shaykh حفظه الله تعالى, he said, first of all, we began by bringing to you the asl, the origin of this innovation. The origin of this innovation and the time when it appears. He said, when he has appeared. He said, the one who follows up and reads in the books that deals with the different types of religions and ideologies, the old ones and the contemporary ones, he will find a very, very important matter, which is all the religions that are being corrupt and changed and altered. You will find that the followers of those religions, they take from one another. They take from one another. But if the religion is preserved and stayed the way it is characterized by many, many features that distinguish it from the corrupt and altered and changed religions. He said, and this innovation, which is the celebration of the Prophet's birthday, it is actually the origin of it. It is found with the people of the past who came before us, with the many different religions who they based their belief on idols, and they believe and they worship idols. He said, it is known to the Greeks, to the pharaohs, and to others that they used to celebrate the birthday of their gods. He said, and what amazing things indeed. How could it be possible for the people to worship a god that he's born, and yet, and they celebrate his birthday? He said, and then the corrupt religions through the time, they inherit these innovations and this evil creed and these celebrations, so much so that for God, they assign to him a day when they celebrate, as they claim, his birthday. نعم يا شيخ.
هذه المواسم وهذه الأعياد إلى الديانة النصرانية بعدما حصل فيها تعارف وترجمة لبعض العقائد اليونانية والبوذية والهندوسية، فصار أعظم شعارات هذه الديانة الاحتفال بالمسيح عليه السلام، بل جعلوا من مولده عليه السلام. ومن المعلوم أن هذا الاحتفال ليس من تعاليم الإنجيل المنزل من الله سبحانه وتعالى، وإنما أدخل باتصال بالثقافات الفلسفية القديمة.
So the Sheikh Hawa Ta'ala, he said, these celebrations actually ends up by being practiced and introduced to Christianity. After that, this Christianity get mixed with other beliefs and other creeds of the Greeks and the Buddhism and others. In the light of translating their work, he says, so therefore, celebrating this celebration became one of the main things actually that distinguished the Christianity, and which consists of celebrating the birthday of the Christ, of Jesus alayhi salam. He said, and it is well known, he said, that this celebration of the birthday of Jesus alayhi salam, it is not from the Injil. You will not find it in the Bible that Isa alayhi salam received from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, this innovation of celebrating the birthday of Jesus alayhi salam was introduced when the Christianity mixed with the philosophy of the deviant and the wicked doctrines at that time. Naam ya Shaykh, sallallahu alayhi.
ثم لما جاء الإسلام الذي يدعو إلى توحيد الله عز وجل وحده لا شريك له، وصرف جميع أنواع العبادة له، وجاء فيه ترتيب كل مصالح الدنيا والآخرة، ومن ذلك ما يتعلق بالأعياد والاحتفالات، فقد بعث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وللناس أعياد يحتفلون فيها، فالعرب لهم أعياد مكانية وزمانية، والنصارى لهم أعياد، وكذلك اليهود، وكذلك سائر الأديان. فبين النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هذه الاحتفالات غير صحيحة، وأن الله عز وجل شرع احتفالين في يومين في كل العام لا ثالث لهما. الأول عيد الفطر بعد صيام شهر رمضان المبارك، فيه يفرح المسلمون الفرح الشرعي لا الفرح المقترن بالمعاصي وكفران النعم، يفرحون بإتمامهم صيام شهرهم ويكبرون الله عز وجل على ما هداهم، كما قال الله عز وجل: ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم، فيكبر المؤمنون: الله أكبر الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله، الله أكبر ولله الحمد. وهكذا في عيد الأضحى يحتفل المسلمون بإتمام نسكهم وهو حج بيت الله، فيشرع لهم فيه أعمال منها الهدي، فيكبرون الله عز وجل على ما رزقهم من بهيمة الأنعام. وأبطل صلى الله عليه وسلم جميع الاحتفالات الأخرى.
الشيخ حفظه تعالى وحفظه الله continue by saying, when Islam comes in, this, the correct Islam, when Islam comes, which calls to the Islamic monotheism, that the only God, true God, worthy of worship is Allah, the creator of the universe. And so therefore, all acts of worship should be devoted for Him alone, with no partners. Islam, the warn against shirk, and to associate partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship, or to worship others beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Islam that did not neglect anything except that will bring the benefit to the people, except the Islam command us with. And from those things that Islam has regulated is the celebrations. Is the celebrations. Is that indeed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to all mankind with Islam. And he found that the people at that time, they used to celebrate many days. He said, as for the Arabs, they used to have specific days and celebrations related to certain times and certain places. The Christians as well, and the Jews and the like of the rest of the different religions, everyone have their own days and places and times when they celebrate. So the Prophet ﷺ, he made it clear for everyone that all of these celebrations are not correct. They're not correct. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated only two celebrations, 2 days in the whole of the year. There is no third one. The first one is the Eid al-Fitr, after completing the fasting of the great month of Ramadan. In this day, the Muslims, they enjoy themselves, the legislative joy that is far away from sins and sinning and being ungrateful to the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, the believers, they are joyful in that day because Allah has allowed them to complete the fasting of this blessed month of Ramadan. So therefore, they praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and glorify Him by making the takbir for that which Allah has guided them to. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, so you may complete the fasting of this month, and then you mention the takbir because of that which Allah has guided you to. So he says, so the believers, they make takbir on that day by saying, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. There is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. Allahu Akbar wa lillahi alhamd. Allah is the greatest and to him belongs all praises. He says, so therefore, and the other Eid and other celebration is the Eid al-Adha, which comes right in the most of the Hajj, the season of Hajj and pilgrimage, to show the joy and thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of that, which Allah allowed the people to make Hajj to continue from the rites of Hajj. So likewise, they glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that which He has provided them with. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has denied and rejected all the rest of the celebration other than these two. Naam, ya Shaykh.
وهكذا استمر المسلمون على الاحتفال بهذين العيدين فقط طيلة 4 قرون. في هذه المدة توسع المسلمون ودخل الناس في دين الله أفواجا واختلطت الحضارات القديمة بالحضارات الإسلامية وتجاور المسلمون مع أهل الديانات السابقة ووثنيين، فبسبب هذا أصبح الناس على أقسام: قسم أحب الإسلام فاعتنقه واتخذه دينا وتمسك بتعاليم الإسلام ظاهرها وباطنها، وقسم كان همه الدنيا ولم يرفع رأسا بإسلام ولا بغيره، فصار يعمل في هذه الدنيا من غير نظر لهذه الشعائر سواء في دينه القديم أو في دين الإسلام. وقسم ثالث تعصب لدينه وأصبح يبحث عن أي مناسبة حتى يظهر دينه القديم تعصبا بغير دليل ليعاند به أهل الحق من المسلمين. وهذا القسم حفظكم الله صار يحرص إقامة الأعياد التي تظهر تمسكه بدينه، ومن ذلك بدعة مولد عيسى عليه السلام. المجاورون للمسلمين يظهرون الفرح البالغ والسرور في يوم مولد عيسى عليه السلام، فأصبح بعض جهلة المسلمين يحاول أن يقلدهم وأن يدخل هذا الاحتفال في شعائر الإسلام. ومن هنا حفظكم الله دخل هذا الاحتفال إلى بعض بلاد المسلمين تقليدا للنصارى، كما قلد النصارى الفراعنة واليونانيين من قبل.
الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى, he said, likewise, the Muslims, they continue to celebrate only these 2 days, only these 2 celebrations, the Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha, only for 4 centuries, for a long 4 centuries. In these 4 centuries, the Muslims, they reached many, many lands. The conquest of the Muslims reached many places. So many people, they accepted Islam and they enter actually to Islam in groups and tribes. So therefore, which bring about a mixture between the Islam and that which those people that used to be before Islam. And likewise, there will be the Muslims, they have so many neighbors who they leave and they have other religions. from the Jews and the Christians and polytheists and the like. So because of this, the people, they divide on two groups. The Sheikh mentioned three groups so far. Number one is a group that they loved the Islam. They were convinced with the teachings of Islam. So therefore they embrace Islam. And they made it their religion. They hold on firm to its teachings. And they benefited from Islam. And they practice it inwardly and outwardly. Another group who all it matters to them is the dunya, is this life, getting a piece of it. They didn't care about Islam the same way they didn't care about the religion before Islam. So they entered to Islam only to seek benefits. So therefore, these are people that didn't benefit from Islam. Their actions are far away from the legislation of Islam, the same way when they used to be upon their old religion. The third group is a type of people who they rejected Islam and they didn't want to accept it. Rather, they hold on firm to their religions. So therefore, being around the Muslims, neighbors of the Muslims, they tried hard to celebrate that which they used to be before. And to show in my city, and I should say, they will practice their celebrations only to go against the truth. To go against the truth. So therefore they were celebrating those innovative celebrations. So that they show to the Muslims that them too, they are holding firm to a religion. And from those innovations is that which they call the birthday of Jesus alayhi salam, or Christmas. So therefore this innovation was practiced by the neighbors of the Muslims, who they began to enjoy and celebrate that day, which is not legislated to them by Allah and by their Lord. So much so that some of the ignorance of the Muslims who don't know Islam, who didn't benefit from the teaching of Islam, they wanted to do as they did. And they tried to emulate their example. And so therefore, slowly, yet, this innovation of the celebration entered to Al-Islam. And so therefore, it originated. And likewise, the Christians, they celebrate the birthday of Jesus. Some of the ignorant Muslims, they began to celebrate the celebration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, only out of imitating the Christians, who themselves, they imitated the previous corrupt creeds from the pharaohs and the Greeks and the like. نعم يا شيخ.
وقد ذكر السخاوي رحمه الله وهو من علماء القرن التاسع الهجري هذا الأمر وجعله دليلا على مشروعية المولد حيث قال رحمه الله إذا كان النصارى اتخذوا ليلة مولد عيسى عيدا فأهل الإسلام أولى أن يتخذوا ليلة مولد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عيدا وهذا في الحقيقة خطأ واضح وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن نتابع أهل الأديان السابقة فيما أخطأوا فيه فهم قد أخطأوا في ابتداء مولد عيسى عليه السلام فلا يجوز لنا أن نتابعهم في هذا الخطأ نعم إذا فعلوا أمرا صوابا نحن نتابعهم عليه فلا يجوز لنا أن نتابعهم عليه فهذا لا يصلح يكون دليل على جواز الاحتفال بمولد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى he said and he mentioned a statement of one of the scholars his name as Sakhawi رحمه الله who is from the scholars of the 9th century of the Hijra, the 9th century of the Hijra. He mentioned this issue of the celebration of the birthday of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Actually, he made actually as a proof for the celebration of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam birthday, the celebration that the Christians they did for the birthday of Jesus Alayhi Salam. And he said, since the Christians, they choose the night where Jesus was born, and they therefore they celebrated it, and they make it as a celebration. So he said, the people of Islam, they have more rights to celebrate. And so therefore, they make from the day where Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was born as a celebration. The Shaykh said, no doubt the statement of this Shaykh is wrong. No doubt about this. That because the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has prohibited us from following the people of the previous religions in that which they err and make mistakes. He said, and no doubt that the Christians, they fall into a grave mistake by celebrating the birthday of Jesus alayhi salam. So therefore, we do not follow them in their mistakes. He said, yes, it is true. If the Christians, for example, they act upon something that is right and correct, then we follow them on that. We should take that haqq. But since they make mistakes and they fall into mistakes and follow their whims and desires, we do not follow them in that. So he said, from this you know that the statement of this Shaykh is not to be taken in consideration, nor it is a correct proof for celebrating the birthday of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Naam, ya Shaykh.
الأمر الثاني متى حدث الاحتفال بمولد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم
صلى الله عليه وسلم
أجمع العلماء رحمهم الله حتى الذين يجيزون عمل المولد أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يحتفل بمولده
صلى الله عليه وسلم
ولا بمولد الأنبياء عليهم السلام من قبله ولم يأمر صلى الله عليه وسلم بذلك ولم يحتفل الصحابة رضي الله عنهم ولا أهل القرون المفضلة الثلاثة بمولد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قبله ولا بمولد أحد من الصالحين من أحدث بدعة الاحتفال بمولد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ومولد غيره من الصالحين في الإسلام حكام الدولة الفاطمية التي نشأت في القرن الرابع والمؤرخون يجمعون على أن هذه الدولة دولة بدعية وأنها أحدثت في الإسلام بدعا كثيرة وأن حكم زمنا طويلا كما ذكر ذلك المقريزي رحمه الله وغيره من العلماء ثم هدأت هذه البدعة بعد سقوط هذه الدولة زمنا في القرن السابع في مكان يقال له إربل ولذلك فإن المتتبع للكتب التي تحدثت عن المولد وحدثت فيه سيرة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تحت مسمى المولد كلها ألفت بعد فهذا يدل على أن هذه البدعة بدعة متأخرة ليست من عمل السلف الصالح رحمهم الله.
So the Sheikh حفظه الله تعالى continue by saying, number two, when, now he's going to bring the time, when this innovation of which consists of celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was introduced. When? What time? He said the scholars has a total agreement. Even those who they are on the opinion that it's permissible to celebrate the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all of them, they agreed that the Prophet himself never celebrated his birthday. And he never celebrated the birthday of any of the Prophet and the Messenger before him. And that the Prophet ﷺ did not command anyone to celebrate his birthday or the birthday of any of the Prophet and the Messenger before him. And the Sahaba, the companions, who they understood this religion better than anybody else, they did not celebrate the birthday of the Prophet ﷺ, nor did they celebrate the birthday of the previous prophets and messengers. Likewise, the people that lived in those three best generations, they did not celebrate the birthday of the Prophet ﷺ, and they did not celebrate the birthday of any prophet or a messenger before him, nor that it was known that they celebrated the birthday of any among the righteous people amongst them. So therefore, actually the time when this bid'ah, this innovation of the celebrating of the Prophet ﷺ birthday and the birthday of the righteous people was introduced by the rulers of this dawla, this country called Al-Fatimiyyah, the Fatimid, that it was founded in the fourth year of the Hijrah. He said the historians who they wrote the history of the dynasties and the countries and the rulers and the like, they have all of the agreement, the total agreement that this dawla, the Fatimiyyah, it was founded on innovations. And so therefore they introduced so many innovations to Islam, and which make it easy for this innovation to spread, that the rulers of this, of the Fatimids, they ruled for a long time. As Al-Maqrizi mentioned this, and other than him, he said, and then these innovations, and especially the one of the celebrating the birthday of the Prophet ﷺ, it cooled down. Especially after the fall of this Fatimids. Until the seventh year of the Hijrah, when it started to become strong once again in a place called Erbil. He said, and the one who read the books of the people of knowledge that speaks about this innovation, he will found that all of these books, they were written after the seventh century of the Hijrah. So I will tell you that this innovation came way late after time of the righteous predecessors in those great generations. نعم يا شيخ.
المسألة الثالثة أسباب انتشار الاحتفال بالمولد في البلاد الإسلامية. أول سبب حفظكم الله لكل بدعة ولكل معصية هو الجهل. فإن الجاهل حفظكم الله يشرع لنفسه أمرا ما أذن الله سبحانه وتعالى له به، ثم يتخذ هذا الأمر دينا، ثم يتقرب إلى الله عز وجل به، ثم يقيم الولاء والبراء عليه، فمن عمله فهو المؤمن ومن تركه فهو المنافق. ولهذا افترقت أمة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولهذا كذلك افترقت بسبب الجهل، افترقوا بسبب الجهل، لأنهم عن تعاليم التوراة الحقة، والنصارى ابتعدوا عن تعاليم التوراة الحقة فافترقوا. وهكذا وقع هذا الأمر في الإسلام، فمن ابتعد عن تعاليم الكتاب والسنة لا بد أن يجهل دينه، فإذا جهل دينه وقع في البدع ووقع في المعاصي ووقع في الشهوات والشبهات. ولذلك من أراد أن يسلم من هذه البدعة ومن غيرها فعليه بالعلم، فإن فيه الهدى والنجاة في الدنيا والآخرة.
The Shaykh Hafidhahu Ta'ala continue by saying, he said, thirdly, he will mention the reasons. What are the reasons that helped for this innovation of the celebrating the birthday of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to spread? And to spread in the Muslim countries. What are the reasons that was behind the celebration and the spreading of this innovation in the Muslim countries? He said, number one, no doubt, he said, that every innovation and every sin you find behind it is jahl, ignorance. He said that because the ignorant one, may Allah preserve me and you from being amongst them. He said the ignorant, he legislate for himself things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not allow. And once he legislate for him things, certain things, it become a religion for him. That's his religion. And so therefore he become, try to use the innovative things to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And based on those innovations, he will love and hate certain people. Those who act upon his innovation, they are the believers to him. Those who forsake those innovations, they are hypocrites to him. And that's why, this is one of the reasons why the Muslims, they separate and divided. The Muslims, they're not the only one that divided, as the Prophet ﷺ informed us. Likewise, the Jews and the Christians, they divide into sects. Why? Simply because of ignorance. Because of the ignorance of that which it was built to them. He said, likewise, the Jews who did not act upon the teachings of their prophets and that which it was sent to them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were divided. Likewise, the Christians who they were ignorant of the teachings and they didn't bring it to application, therefore they become divided. So he said, likewise, the Muslims and in general, whoever turned away from the teachings of the Quran and the teaching of the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, no doubt person, he does not know his deen. He's ignorant of his deen. And so if he is ignorant of his religion, that lead him and push him to fall into innovations and sins, in desires and lust and doubtful things. The Shaykh says, so therefore, whoever wants to be safe and to be away from innovations and sins and desires and doubtful matters, there is no other way except that he has to seek knowledge. The knowledge of this, of Islam, which contains guidance and safety in this life and in the hereafter. Now, Shaykh, sallallahu alayhi wa
sallam. Al-amru al-thani, استغلال أهل العقائد الباطلة لهذه المناسبة لنشر عقائدهم الباطلة كما فعل الفاطميون قديما، وكما يفعل كثير من أهل البدع اليوم لنشر عقائدهم الباطلة، ويستغلونه لكسب الأتباع لطريقتهم أو حزبهم تحت ستار محبة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وآل بيته، وربما هم في الحقيقة أعداء للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولآل بيته.
الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى said, reason number two is the fact that the people who spread these innovations, they take advantage of the like of these celebrations to spread and disseminate many, many other innovations and evil. The likewise the Fatimis did in the first place. And likewise the people of innovations and through all the times and in this time, especially in these times, they use the like of this innovation, which is the celebration of the birthday of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, to spread many, many other innovations, only to increase their members and their followers, and only to strengthen their groups and the like. All of this under one umbrella, love for the Prophet ﷺ and his family members. They claim because they celebrate the birthday of the Prophet ﷺ, they are the one truly that love the Prophet ﷺ. That's what they claim. The Shaykh said, in reality, they are the enemies to the Prophet ﷺ. They are his enemies in reality and the enemies of his family members. Naam, ya Shaykh.
السبب الثالث وصيتي وكسب المال، فقد ظهر بسبب هذه البدعة صناعات كثيرة درت أموالا طائفة على متخذيها، فألفت القصص والمدائح وصنعت الأشرطة والاحتفالات الكثيرة التي تسبب شهرة لهؤلاء المداحين أو هؤلاء الشعراء أو تدر مالا لمن يصنع هذه البدعة، فلذلك تمسك كثير من الناس بها.
The Sheikh said number three, the reason number three for the spread of this wicked innovation, it has something to do with economy and money. He says, since now there is so many people that celebrate this innovation, so therefore those people who spread it and they want to keep it alive and to get more people involved in celebrating it, because they make money. They make money. He said, because these people who celebrate, they need many things to celebrate. Food, they listen to music, they hire people to come and recite lines of poetry. People, they in these celebrations, they have to wear new clothing. They have to do certain things, so therefore it become an economy. Is those people who they constantly push this innovation because it bring them money. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ It bring them money. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ So therefore, they hold on firm to it and they do whatever it takes to keep it on. They don't want to lose their money. نعم يا شيخ.
السبب الرابع وهو ما يحدث في الاحتفالات الشعبية، وهي التي تكون في الشوارع أو في الساحات العامة في بعض البلاد الإسلامية، فإنها أماكن يجتمع فيها الرجال والنساء، ومحبو اللهو هذه الاجتماعات ويحرصون على حضورها لمآربهم الخبيثة. وقد ضج علماء العالم الإسلامي مما يجري في هذه الاجتماعات من فسق ونحوه، حتى أفتى كثير منهم بتحريم مثل هذه الاجتماعات.
الشيخ تعالى He said the fourth reason behind the spreading of this wicked innovation, which consists of celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is the fact that this innovation is not, it has something to do with the places that this celebration takes place. He said in many Muslim countries you find that the celebrations of this innovation take place in streets and take place in parks, downtown and the like, places that are very known to the people. So many people come together, men and women, they gather together. And so therefore, people in there, they prepare for the music, dancing, entertainment in general. They have what they want. He said, for the wicked people, they have wicked hearts. And those who they love to mix, they love to be in those despicable places. So therefore, they spread this innovation and they support it. And the people of knowledge, they warn against these kind of types of celebrations and these gatherings. So actually some of the people of knowledge, he bring fatwa, Islamic verdict, that is haram and not permissible to be around those areas and to be among those people when they gather together to celebrate this wicked innovation. Naam ya Shaykh, sallallahu alayhi.
وهناك سبب مهم ذكره أحد علماء النفس، وهو أن الإنسان يحب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، أو نقول يحب كل من يعظمه كمحبة بعض النصارى لعيسى عليه السلام، لكنه يشعر بقارة نفسه أنه مقصر في حقه. فعندما يقال له أحيي هذه الليلة بالفرح والأكل والشرب والرقص والغناء وقد أديت حق هذا المعظم عليك، يفرح بهذا. وضرب لهذا مثالا بعيد الأم، فإن كثيرا من الناس قد عق أمة ولكنه يتألم في قرارة نفسه ويحب أن يعطيها حقها لفضلها عليه، فيقال له تعال يوم عيد الأم وأعطها هدية أو أعطها وردة وتكون قد أديت حقها، وهو في الحقيقة لم يؤدي حقها في هذه الهدية ولا هذه الوردة، لأن حقها عظيم عليه. الحقيقة لن نؤدي حق من نعظمه بهذه الليلة التي نحييها لعظيم حق نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم علينا.
الشيخ حفظه الله تعالى said, and there is another reason, it is very important one, and this reason is being mentioned by one of the scholars and the doctors, or like a psychic that deals with psychology. And he mentioned, he said that the person who loves something or who loves someone, he always finds that he's attached to it. He said, for example, those people who love the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they love the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The place of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in their hearts is big. But in the same way that some of the Christians, they love Jesus Alayhi Salam. But in the same time, you find these people, they always telling themselves that they are reluctant, negligent, and they are not doing what they should to actually give the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam the rights that he due to him. And so they're constantly thinking about this. So when the people, that when they are introduced to this innovation, and when it's said to them, celebrate the birthday of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, eat, drink, dance, do what you want to do in this night, this is how you're going to pay the rights of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is how you're going to express your love and your respect to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and therefore he wants and do it. Thinking that by him doing this, he really is respecting the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and loving him and the like. He said, and this doctor here, he set an example of the mother day. The mother day. He said, many people, they don't care about their mothers. Many people, they are disrespectful to their mothers. They hit them, they beat them and the like. But maybe sometimes they may feel a kind of type of way that I shouldn't do this. This is my mother. My mother have done so much for me. They feel bad. So you find some people, they take advantage of this. And they tell them, you know what? On a mother day, send her a gift. Send her a rose. And I will do it. And that's what they do exactly. Because they feel that guilt for their mothers. They didn't take care of their mothers. They could not give their mothers the right that is due to them. They send them a card or a rose, thinking that they will pay the rights that their mothers have over them. The Sheikh said that gift and that rose will never ever take a place. Any effort that the person should do to display his love and his respect and how dutiful he should be to his mother. Likewise, the celebrations, the food, the dancing, the music, the chanting, the haram gathering will never ever be a legislative mean to show that a person cares about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Naam, Sheikh.
آخر سبب حفظكم الله ذكره الجبرتي المؤرخ، وقال إن الاستعمار الفرنسي لما دخل مصر كان ينشر بدعة المولد. كان نابليون بونابرت يأمر نفسه بإقامة المولد ويحضر المولد بنفسه. فهل بونابرت كان مسلما معظما للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ الجواب لا. ولكن لماذا؟ قال الجبرتي رحمه الله: لأنه رأى في هذه الموالد الخروج عن الشرائع واجتماع النساء والرجال واتباع الشهوات والرقص وفعل المحرمات، وهذه الأمور الشنيعة تضعف الإسلام والمسلمين. فإذا ضعف الإسلام والمسلمون هانا وسهل استعمارهم عسكريا واقتصاديا وفكريا.
The Shaykh حفظه الله تعالى, he said, the last reason he will bring behind the spread, the widespread of this wicked innovation, which is the celebration of the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is mentioned by this historian called Al-Jabrati, and he mentioned that, and this has to do with the fact when the French, they colonized Egypt, when Egypt was a colony under the ruling of the French in a time of Napoleon Bonaparte. This man, this French ruler, he used to command, and his command that the birthday of the Prophet ﷺ to be celebrated in Egypt. And he would make sure that everybody celebrate, give them what they need to celebrate this innovation. He said, was Napoleon Bonaparte a Muslim? Of course, the answer is no. So why is he celebrating the birthday of the Prophet ﷺ? And he used to be amongst them. He was not a Muslim, yet he celebrated the birthday of the Prophet ﷺ, and he pushed it and sponsored it. Why? He said, for one reason. Because he saw in this innovation that the people stay away from the legislation of Al-Islam, whereas men and women gather together. They dance, they listen to music, they follow their desires, and they fall into all types of haram, all types of prohibitions, which weakened Islam and the Muslims, and therefore it became easy for those Muslim countries to fall as a prey and become an easy target, a colony for others. And so therefore, it'd be easy for them to get in and be easy for them to take their wealth and their righteousness. نعم يا شيخ.
ساعة انتهت الآن وبقي عندي عنوان لماذا ننكر بدعة المولد في هذا الزمان. أخشى لا يتسع الوقت لها.
لعل نذكره في وقت آخر يا شيخ.
إن شاء الله لعلنا في وقت آخر.
الله يبارك.
لماذا ننكر بدعة المولد في هذا الزمان؟
إن شاء الله لعلنا
في وقت آخر إن شاء الله.
نخصص له محاضرة أخرى إن شاء الله.
بإذن الله.
الله يجزيكم خير يا شيخ وأحسن الله إليكم وبارك فيكم, ونسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يدخر لكم هذه الجهود خالصة لكم يوم نلقاه. بارك الله فيكم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. The Sheikh has said maybe another time inshallah ta'ala he will elaborate on this title. لماذا ننكر هذه البدعة؟ Why do we refute this innovation, which is the celebration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam birthday? So in the end, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that allow us to gather today in this place. And I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guiding us to Al-Islam, this great ni'mah. Guide us to Al-Islam. And you should know and remember that being guided to Al-Islam is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has nothing to do with who you are, how do you look, how strong you may be. It has nothing to do with wealth or nothing. It is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that should be preserved. And there is many ways that we preserve it. It's by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it, by acting upon that which Allah has legislated, by asking Allah for forgiveness, by asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us firm upon this gift which is Islam. And after that, I thank our beloved Sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab Al-Aqil, حفظه الله تعالى.